is all right with everybody. I will try and speak slowly, and if there is any question, you can please ask me. I come from India, and I have a daughter who's 13 and she's deaf, and that working with her has inspired me to talk about more about children. So I help children with deafness, and I talk to the parents and help them to see how they can make their children speak. So I give free advice on deafness, and that's how I have come across Ms. Hariyati. And Dr. Hariyati is very kind. She's given me a second chance to talk about child abuse, and I'm very happy to be part of some very esteemed speakers. So today I will talk about child abuse in disabled children, which is a very serious offense, I feel. It does, they already have disability to handle, and then on top of it, there is more chances of these children to have abuse as part of their lives. So I have prepared some slides, and I hope that it will help you understand what I want to speak. My first, this is abuse and prevention of abuse in disabled children. How we can, we will talk about it. Next slide. Why disabled kids are at high risk of abuse? Most of these children, they are very vulnerable. They do not have defenses, and most of the time you will see that if they are not given enough support, they have a chance of being abused. So what are the reasons? One of, they are three times more at risk as they are vulnerable and easy targets because they do not, are they not able to express, sometimes they are a little afraid. They have incapability because of some handicap. They are three times more likely to be abused. Kids with mental and intellectual disability are at higher risk compared to physical deformity. So when physical deformity actually can be a little more bigger deterrent, where unless it's a mental disability and an intellectual disability, mental retardedness, they are more prone to have more abuse. Kids with unsupported or overwhelmed parents are at a higher risk. Where parents do not support a child who is disabled, they have a bigger chance of getting abuse because they are looking outside of their homes to get support. So unless you have parents or family supporting them, you are actually putting your children who's already disabled to be at a higher risk. Mostly abused by caretakers and someone they know, as they are more isolated and independent. Most of the time, because these children are already disabled, they are dependent on some caregiver if it's a physical disability, or for example Down syndrome where somebody has to explain, or deafness where somebody has to explain, they have a bigger chance of being abused by the very person who is taking care of them, family members, neighbors, relatives, who they are normally surrounded by. Because they are mostly dependent on them and they are isolated from society, so these children are more vulnerable. More bullying at schools and social gatherings. So you will see that because these children go to school, they again have a smaller circle. Sometimes the teachers are not able to understand what their needs are, and they have a bigger chance of being abused. Unable to communicate effectively and report, and may not be believed. Most of the time it happens that some of them may not have the language or the expression to explain to the caregiver or the teachers or family that they are being abused, and hence they and nobody may even believe them. They may think that people are he's making up stories. So one of the reasons could be that also. Now we talk about types of abuse. There are various kinds of abuses, not just sexual, or they are one is emotional. You kind of keep reminding them, oh, you have this problem, you know, you are a burden to me, you are not good enough. So this kind of emotional blackmail or torture to the child makes them very weak and vulnerable. Then they start looking for support outside of that area and look for support. And that can be a reason just to get that love. They start taking that love as part of the abuse. Physical, non-supportive, hitting, child labor. Some of these children are not able to understand much, so they accept that physical abuse, like even child labor, parents or family asking them to do menial jobs, cleaning the house, because they think that this is a way of getting them, you know, some easy work done, could also be or hitting them or beating them, closing them in the room, just because they do not want them to be a menace in the house. So this is another form. Mental, you ignore them, you behave as if they don't exist, you insult them in public, or you instill fear in them. You scream at them so much that they are afraid. That is also a very big abuse. Then again, sexual. Now, because these children are so vulnerable, they are so afraid, they're not able to explain. Somebody comes and holds them, loves them. They feel that they are being cared for. They really love the person, the child. And hence, they start opening up with that stranger or caregiver or family, and then another door of child abuse can open. So we have to be very careful that these are the four major signs which are types of abuse. Effects of abuse. What are the effects? They have long-term trauma leading to regression. They go back. They have fear and hallucination. They start to imagine things. They have a lot of fear. Depression and aggression. Because they are abused, they either can go into a depression because it's very difficult for them to handle, and or they can also get very aggressive. They will fight, they will throw things, they will shout, and that is a way of expressing their problems. Then they can also self-harm, means cutting themselves, hitting themselves, hurting them, beating themselves, screaming, shouting, pulling their hair out is another form of abuse that they have. Then again, isolation. They decide not to talk to anybody. They want to just be alone. Somebody wants to talk to them, they just push them away. How can we prevent it? Next slide. Prevention. How can you prevent this? We keep a special watch on these children, have security cameras, give them, ask your neighbors, family, who you can trust, to take care of them and watch for any signs where there could be a problem. Educate and make the child aware about the good and bad. Tell them about the good touch, bad touch. Tell them what is acceptable, what is not acceptable, which is very, very important. Then watch for signs of abuse. What are the signs that the child is being abused? Keep a watch on them. They could have some bites, some hurt, some whipping marks, or the child is very scared of something. Those are all signs that they are being abused. Talk to your child very often. In different ways, try to find out what's happening in your child, and they will normally give signs where they can show you that there is a kind of abuse. SOS measures, give them emergency numbers, pepper spray, so that they can defend themselves in case there is an abuse. Last slide, measures. We empathize, listen and support. Give them a lot of support, listen to them and empathize with them. That's very important. Reassure, don't blame them because it's not their fault. They just don't know any better. Report to authorities as needed. Speak to the police or your NGO which can help this child. And look for a counselor who can give them support in case of abuse. And this is my email, ruchi.6@gmail.com, and I'm a blogger at Impaired But Empowered. It was wonderful to speak to all of you. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure being here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Ruchi Goyal. Sebagai tambahan sebetulnya, menarik sekali.